would have kind of found some sort of way to not teach what's needful to be taught. I'm not that way. You know, I think, well, boy, we need to address doctrine. I don't want to forsake doctrine. And with that, most of this is doctrinal, and we'll try to give you some personal application by the end of today's message. I've titled it The Humble Entry as opposed to The Triumphal Entry, and I've done that for a reason. But we're looking at John chapter 12, verses 12 through 19 this morning, and my close-up vision goes in and out. So bear with me here. Let's go ahead and, yeah, I think there's a lot here for us to dig into. I just don't know if I've done it justice this morning. You'll have to let me know. Okay, so verses 12 through 19. On the next day, much people that were come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna! Blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. And Jesus, when he had found a young ass, sat thereon, as it is written, Fear not, daughter of Sion. Behold, thy king cometh sitting on an ass's colt. These things understood not his disciples at the first, but when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him, and that they had done these things unto him. The people therefore that was with him when he called Lazarus out of his grave and raised him from the dead bear record. For this cause the people also met him, for that they heard that he had done this miracle. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, Perceive ye how ye prevail nothing? Behold, the world is gone after him. Okay, so this is our text from this morning, and let's see what the Lord will draw out here. Let's see what he's got. Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you for saving me. Thank you for saving my brothers and sisters here. Hoping, Lord, that every single person in this room has trusted you for salvation, Lord. If not, that today would be the day. And Lord, we just thank you so much for giving us 66 books from which to glean doctrine, from which to glean application, Lord, from which to be encouraged, to be chastised when we're needed. Thank you for the Holy Spirit sealing us unto redemption and also guiding us through those 66 books of the Bible. And ultimately, Lord, this morning as we sit here and look at the text, Lord, Holy Spirit, I pray that you would impress upon us the thing that is necessary for each and every person individually. Speak to our hearts, and may we have hearts to receive, Lord God, ears to hear, eyes to see what you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Close my eyes too long. Give me a second. Refocus. Okay, here we go. John 12, verses 12 and 13. I'm at that stage right now with this LASIK where I don't know if I need readers yet. So it's blurry, but it's a little better this way, not so good this way. And I don't know if it's just the LASIK or I'm just getting old. 12 and 13. On the next day, much people that were come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna! Blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. This desire of the people to see Jesus and to celebrate his arrival into Jerusalem is only days away from the same people agreeing with the priests to crucify him. Now look at Mark 12. Keep your place here. Mark 12. What a fickle people we are. I was going to put up, somebody sent me this link on a Facebook about a shepherd. He's leading a bunch of sheep across the road, and they said, be warned for all pastors out there, and something akin to that, and so I had to repost that, but I was going to put it up here. Man walking across the street with his sheep.
And man, oh man, they just attacked him. They just beat the tar out of him, knocked him down, and then the one ran its head right into his face. And it's just like, this is what it's like to be a pastor. I don't know why that came in. That just came in. It's just there. But I was going to share that with you this morning. I was laughing. I thought it was funny. Good stuff. All right, 35 through 37. And Jesus answered and said, while he taught in the temple, how say the scribes that Christ is the son of David? For David himself said by the Holy Ghost, the Lord said to my Lord, sit thou on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. David therefore himself calleth him Lord. And whence is he then his son? And here's the point I even brought you here. And the common people heard him what? Common people heard him gladly. Common people love Jesus. Now, and I think that they still do, even today. And sorry if this is offensive to you, but I think this room is filled with a lot of common folk. Everyday people. You know, not the weirdos of Hollywood and not the, you know, the people making $1 million or more a year. You know, I mean, we're just common, the middle class, the common people, right? But we're common, biblical, faith-based people, right? But my question becomes this. Where are the common people later on when the greatest miscarriage of justice takes place, when Jesus is forced before a wicked man to determine whether or not he should live? Where were they then? These people that are throwing the branches on the ground right now, Hosanna, Hosanna, where were they when the priests were dragging him off to be crucified? It's just me, you know, I thought about that. I know that the priests were very persuasive when it came to Herod, when it came to Pilate. They were very persuasive, and they were persuasive over the people. But where was the gumption to stand up for what you say you believe in? I want to know where it is today. All right, look at John 19. A lot of what we're dealing with here this morning is very Jewish. It's not, you know, I'm trying to draw something out here for the church, but this is not for the church. And I'll explain how and why. John 19, verses 12 through 15. And from thenceforth, Pilate sought to release him, that being Jesus, of course. But the Jews cried out, saying, if thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. You can see how persuasive they were to Pilate, right? I mean, back in the day, you didn't just get kicked out of office. You had your head lobbed off. So, right? That's what Pilate was afraid of, right? Whosoever maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar. When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in the Hebrew, Gabbatha, or Gabbatha. And it was the preparation of the Passover, about the sixth hour, and he said unto the Jews, behold your king! But they cried out, away with him, away with him, crucify him! Pilate saith unto them, shall I crucify your king? The chief priests answered, we have no king but Caesar. That is going to stay with the nation of Israel for a long time. We have no king but Caesar. How quickly these scribes and Pharisees and Sadducees and chief priests, etc., who are all about the law of Moses, how quickly they forget their own writings. You know what Psalm 47:6 says? It says, sing praises to God. Sing praises unto our King. Sing praises. God our King. God our King. Now we're going to have to, when we get to the 19th chapter of John, we're going to have to revisit this. And I think this could be a kind of a standalone message. But I couldn't help but kind of preview it this morning. I know where the commoners are now in this story. They're excitingly prepared to receive their king. They're throwing down the branches. Hosanna, Hosanna. This is the king of, you know, this is the son of David. This is our king. This is our Messiah. This is the governor. The government's going to be upon his shoulders, etc., etc. But again, I'm not sure where they're going to be in a few days. This same group is excited. Where are they later? The scripture's silent. We know what the priests are plotting. We know what Pilate's doing. We know what Herod's doing. We don't know what the common folk are doing. Right? I don't know him. Weren't you the guy just throwing branches down on the ground? No, wasn't me. Wasn't me. Did they run and hide? Did they change their minds to follow the priests? Were they just kind of laying low to see, well, how's this all going to turn out? Listen, I've learned this much in my life. Crowds follow crowds. And the Lord, in his comparing people to sheep, that's not an incorrect assessment. I know it's offensive to a lot of people, but it's not incorrect. You get one or two sheep to move, the rest are just going to follow along. That's just the way it goes. But the key is the head sheep that everyone's following, is he following his shepherd? Because if that head sheep isn't following the shepherd, they're just going with that sheep. That's what they know. They will turn away from the shepherd. So you've always got to make sure that you've got an under-shepherd, a pastor, who's following the over-shepherd. That's the way it's got to be. It's got to be. Got to be. And I don't know, these people, they were following the priests. They weren't following their God. So, large churches, folks, large churches continue to bring in numbers. It's just the way it is. It's the way it is. When a visitor comes into a small congregation, I've just got to believe, based on the conversations that I've had with people, that they kind of wonder, well, what's wrong here? Right? Because if it was larger, then we would understand, you know, things were good. You got small numbers. Something's not right here. It might actually be the other way around. Not to say that a large church can't be a good church. Okay? Understand. I'm not going to go, rah, 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 small churches, because we've got a small church, which would make sense, right? But, so the people are here. They're here today. They're here with Jesus today. Gone tomorrow. And I just think that there's a lot to be said about that. And I think it reflects on church people and their fickleness, myself included, you know, to just be rah-rah one moment and then to stab someone in the back the next moment they get. It's just in us. It's a sad reality. And I think, you know, what people do to churches and to church life in today's day and age, they did it to Jesus first on a very personal level. So I'm not trying to be mean to anyone here this morning. I'm just saying, right? Now, this event here, we know often as the triumphal entry, and this event brought on that tradition that is called, anyone know the tradition? What do people celebrate? What?
Palm Sunday.
Quite honestly, this event has nothing to do with the church. I don't know why the church celebrates it. Not wrong to celebrate it, but it has nothing to do with the church. I've never bothered to do anything, you know, with the palms. To me, it was always like, well, there's just more work I got to create. You know, we got to bring in the palms, got to purchase the palms, got to shape them into crosses for everybody, hand them out to everybody so that they can put them on the refrigerator until they get sick of looking at them. Amen. That's right. Come on. Every year. That's how it went down. You remember there was a day when you went to one of those churches. I know it. You know, we're in Buffalo. It is what it is. I never found it necessary. I don't know. You know, maybe it's because I'm such an anti-traditional kind of guy, but I also understand doctrinally this has nothing to do with the church. This is all about the nation of Israel receiving their king. That's what it's about. Now look at verses 14 and 15. This is a very Jewish event. And Jesus, when he had found a young ass, sat thereon, as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of the church. Behold, thy king cometh." Oh, wait a minute. I misread there. Must have been the LASIK. "Fear not, daughter of" what? Zion. That's not the church. Behold, thy king cometh sitting on an ass's colt. Now let's look at the full quote. It's from Zechariah 9:9, second to last book of the Old Testament. Go ahead and flip back there. Just before Malachi. This is the quotation. Just want you to see where it is, where you find it. Written hundreds of years before Jesus Christ rode into Jerusalem to fulfill it. Amen. Yeah. Yeah. Good, what, 700 years, I'm wanting to think? 700 years about? That would be quite a prophecy to fulfill. So here it is. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion, with a Z. It's interesting. You know, I don't know what to make of that. You know, you've got an S. You've got a Z. I've heard people say, well, the S is the heavenly Zion, and the Z is the earthly Zion. I don't know. Yeah, that's what it is. It's the Greek to English transliteration of the word Zion. There's no, you know, there's, it's more of an S-like sound in and you know me, I'm not a Greek and a Hebrew guy, but the King James translators were honest. That's what you don't get with New International Version, with, you know, New King James, all that stuff. They're not honest. They change things because they think, well, that's how it's supposed to be. Whereas the King James translator said, no, this is what it said.
Amen.
And if it didn't say it, and we needed to add to the text, we let you know by putting those words in italics so that it could bring in the understanding. Now, my personal opinion is that the italics were also inspired. But talk to me some other time about that, and I'll explain to you why. If they weren't, you'd have a mistake in your Bible. Who killed Goliath? Who killed Goliath? Who? Well, I mean, what human being killed Goliath? David. Now, not in the New King James Bible, not in the NIV, not in the American Standard. Say, what do you mean? Well, they left out italicized words. And when they did that, they made someone else kill Goliath. I'll show you. Ask me sometime and I'll show you. I'm not going to do it right now. So the Lord is fulfilling prophecy through this event. He's riding into Jerusalem on a very specific day, only to be cut off and killed as Daniel prophesies. Right? We know that that was going to happen. Now this event is often, again, it's referred to as the triumphant or triumphal entry. In fact, a number of my Bibles have that. If you have headings, that's what it says. I think even the Scofield says the triumphal entry. But publishers write that stuff. That's not God. Okay, your comments in there, your cross references, that's all human beings. Right? We understand that. So I don't know. I don't consider this a triumphal entry unless what he's coming in to triumph over is not government, but the need for salvation. Got it? Jesus is not riding into Jerusalem as a conquering and a triumphant king. That's not why he's coming. He's riding into Jerusalem as a humble and suffering prophet. This is a death ride. He doesn't think he's going to go take a throne. He's not riding in to proclaim his earthly kingdom. He's riding in to make his spiritual kingdom accessible to everyone. What he does right now, he's not doing to be king. He's doing it out of love. With great agony of spirit, which we'll read about in the 17th chapter. What he does out of necessity for a majority who couldn't care less about him. Amen. And a minority who will receive him and love him and desire his company, and hopefully that's us. Amen? So in verses 14 and 15, I do not believe we see the triumphal entry. I don't believe we see a conquering king. He's a king because God is a king, according to Psalm 47. Right? But he's not coming to conquer and to take over the land. He's coming to die and to save sinners, and praise the Lord that he did that first. So that said, these verses are a reflection of a lowly entry. and the offering of the kingdom of God as opposed to the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of God being the spiritual kingdom associated with salvation and the Spirit of God. And because that kingdom was rejected, the other kingdom of heaven, physical, by default was denied this generation. They could have had it. If they would have received the first, the second would have been given to them. But, verse 16, let's keep moving. See, I know this stuff is doctrinal. For a lot of people, it's like, right? But this is, hey, this is just, this is your preacher. This is the kind of guy he is. I want you to understand the Bible. Verse 16, these things understood not his disciples at the first. I think a lot of us still don't. But when, verse 16, John 12, 16, these things understood not his disciples at the first, but when Jesus was, what? Glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him and that they had done these things unto him. So he comes in at this moment, dying for the sins, the lowly prophet. He was buried. He rose again 3 days and three nights later. Right now, our Lord, he is abiding as an intercessory priest, sitting at the right hand of the Father. And any time either you or I sin before the Lord, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, acting as a priest saying, covered in the blood, covered in the blood, covered in the blood, covered in the blood. They are not going to be punished. And let me tell you something. I'm sure that God the Father and I'm sure God the Son get angry at us from time to time. But that advocate is a constant reminder at the right hand of the throne of God that your sins are not going to be counted against you if you've received Jesus Christ, if you've been born again. That's what he does now. He came as a prophet, dying as a prophet. All prophets get martyred. He now abides a priest. But as we sang, there is coming a day. That's when he's coming as. He's going to ride in after his glorification. This is all after the glorification. He's coming as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You read about that in Revelation chapter 19. And I think that day's coming soon. Now that is a triumphal entry. Not on an ass to be killed, but on a stallion to reign. And that's coming. So right here, he came for Zion to fulfill prophecy. Listen, her rejection of the spiritual kingdom of God, that granted access to us. So praise the Lord. Glad it turned out that way. Not so much for Jerusalem, but for me. Right. Listen, no, we're all selfish. Amen. You can amen that. Including the day you got saved. Why? Why did you get saved? It wasn't for someone else. It was so I don't have to go to hell. Right. Amen. That's the way it is. Oh, I'm thankful that they did what they did. And I'm thankful that I have what I have. Praise the Lord. Now, I also think we ought to be, as the scripture says, praying for the peace of Jerusalem. And we ought not turn our back on that nation. So keep praying. Keep praying, man. Things are going down in Israel. The UN's going to be doing other stuff. They are actually now seeking to break up the land and to divide it and to redistribute it. The Lord pronounces a woe in the scripture against those who would divide his land for gain. It's coming. There's a storm a-brewing. But again, had Israel received the spiritual kingdom, I believe right then and there, Jesus would have been crucified as it was. A few days later, he would have still gone to the cross. If they had received that, he would have still gone to the cross. Say, why would he have gone to the cross? He had to fulfill prophecy, Isaiah 53 in particular. He had to die. He had to die for the sins of the people. And then what would have happened? Well, I believe that Judas Iscariot would have risen up. It's all conjecture. I believe John the Baptist would have been Elijah, which was for to come. And I believe Judas would have risen up and he would have been Antichrist for the 7 years because that prophecy has to be fulfilled. So what would have happened to the church age? There wouldn't have been one. Now, I understand that this stuff is debated and debatable, but it's what I believe. I do not believe that God screwed up and that so now plan B is in existence. Okay, this was his plan all along, but the offer of the kingdom to the nation of Israel was legitimate. God doesn't lie. Behold, thy king cometh, if you will receive it. Well, but they didn't. And it's not like he went, oh no, what do I do now? Okay, let's plan the church age. That's not how it was. He knew it all along. But he made a legitimate offer to the nation of Israel. Let me show you Matthew chapter 11. How very different things would have been. He said, well, would I have been born? Would I have been saved? Yeah, probably. Things would have just started in the millennium. And then it goes out into eternity and all that. And Matthew 11. Verses 10 through 14. For this is he of whom it is written, they're talking about John the Baptist here, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist, notwithstanding he that is least in the kingdom of heaven, there's a physical kingdom, is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. That's how I know the kingdom of heaven is a physical kingdom. It can be fought over. Wars are waged over it. They're dividing the land about it right now. Kingdom of heaven is this planet. It's what Satan ruled back before Adam and Eve. He ruled this planet. This was his. It was his kingdom. He had a vested interest in it when it was taken from him, when he fell, when iniquity was found in him. It was then reformed, remade. It was given over to the sons of man. It was given over to Adam and Eve, Adam in particular. And Satan had a vested interest in that. That was his desire to have that kingdom. So he stole it back. How did he get it back? From Adam. How? Because Adam fell and became one of his. So now God, Satan is the god of this world. And all this is all in the scripture. It's all over the place in the scripture, but it's all in the scripture. It's now Satan's kingdom, and he wants it, and he fights over it, and he's violent about it, and the sons of men want it, and they fight over it and are violent about it. And why this little sliver of land in the middle of the desert? Who cares about Israel? There's nothing there. There's no diamonds there. There's no gold there. There's nothing there of value. And yet they're all fighting over it. Why? Because God finds it valuable.
Right.
And so that should just tell you right then and there that this is a spiritual event that's going on. Otherwise, who would care about that land? It doesn't mean anything. But you see, it's the capital of the kingdom of heaven. And Satan has a vested interest in it, and God has a vested interest in it, and so the forces shall meet. And of course, always, the Lord's side is a small army. And it's the hosts that are against him. You look around, it's Muslim from North Africa, in through Middle East, into Asia, up into Europe. It's Muslim. And one teeny little sliver in the middle of it. And the UN can't even let Israel have that. I'm telling you, stuff's going to happen. Stuff's going to happen. That's the kingdom they're all fighting over. So the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. Now, verse 14. And if you will receive it. Receive what? What's the context of the previous verses? The kingdom of heaven. If you will receive it, this, referring to John the Baptist, is Elias, which was for to come. When they asked John the Baptist, are you Elijah? He said no. He didn't think he was. When they asked Jesus about John the Baptist, he said, greatest man ever born, greatest prophet ever born. Anything more? Yeah, if you will receive the kingdom of heaven, he's Elijah. That's what he said. That's who he would be. And Elias being the Greek to English transliteration again of the word, the name Elijah. Honest translation of the scripture by our King James translators. Amen. Now look at Malachi chapter 4. This is prophecy, folks. It could have happened right then and there. He would have become Elijah. But he didn't. Malachi 4. So, before the Lord returns and establishes his kingdom here as the kingdom of heaven on earth, Elijah's got to come. Malachi 4, verses 5 and 6. Now, in what form? I'm not sure. Probably one of the two witnesses, but that's debatable too. Verses 5 and 6. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. That is not the great and dreadful day of the Lord. That is not his time coming to die on the cross. It's his wrath upon earth. That's the second half of the tribulation. All right? So I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. By the way, the two witnesses are there for the second half of the tribulation. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. So this is why many believe Elijah will be one of the two witnesses during the tribulation. I've presented some other options, but it doesn't have to be anyone. I mean, Elijah could just come, right? Doesn't have to be one of the two witnesses, so I don't know. But he will turn the hearts of the Jewish people towards the Lord before the Lord's second coming. But had the Jews been willing, right then and there, unless Jesus is lying, both kingdoms were available to them. They just needed to receive the spiritual revelation first. And then the tribulation would have happened. Jesus would have died. Tribulation would have happened. But because Israel refused, here we are 2,000 years later. And again, I praise the Lord for it. Because now I'm in on it. Praise the Lord. So there's a lot there, I know, and perhaps a bit confusing for some of you that are new to the faith or perhaps new to your Bible study. Forgive me for racing through it. I don't know that I have the time necessary to do a proper Bible study on it, but if there's any questions, I'll gladly receive them. How about that? A worship service, and he's asking if anybody has any questions. You're just completely crazy this morning, Pastor, right? All right. Okay, fine. We all get it. Everyone understood everything of that. That makes me feel much better about myself. Thank you. Verses 17 and 18. Back to our text in John. Let's get some practical things to apply to our lives before we go home. This is the stuff that some of you really, really love, and this is the stuff that some of you really, really hate because it's preaching and it brings conviction. Really, isn't that kind of, don't we fit into one category or the other, usually, typically? I either like the preaching and the hard stuff, and I just like that, and the doctrinal stuff is like, right? Or I like the doctrinal stuff. Let's talk about the sons of God. Let's talk about prophecy. And then he starts preaching about service and giving and things. Spare me, preacher, right? That's kind of how we are. Verses 17 and 18. The people, therefore, that was with him when he called Lazarus out of his grave and raised him from the dead, bear record. For this cause, the people also met him, for that they heard that he had done this miracle. Did you get that? Do I need to preach this? People bear record of Jesus to other people so that the other people will then go and check those things out for themselves. God uses people to get to people. The gospel of Jesus Christ is not being sounded out by an angel. Now, the everlasting gospel will. So that's Revelation. That's the time of the tribulation. Right, that'll be the Jews and angels. Right now, it's you or it's nobody. Look at Romans 1. Let's start with verse 8, and then we'll jump down to 16. Can you imagine if everybody in Erie County that says that they're born again stood out on some street corner with gospel tracts or a sign or willing to preach, there wouldn't be a street corner that was empty? Where are they? Sitting comfortably in their church, sipping on their coffee. Yeah, man. Verse 8. Listen, I know it's cold now. We've got a winter reprieve. See you in the summer. See you in the spring, I should say. Romans 1, verse 8. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all that your faith is spoken of throughout the world, the whole world. Is it? What about your faith? Is it spoken of throughout your whole house? Let's start there. Is it spoken of throughout your workplace? Is it spoken of throughout your community? Or do they talk about other things? Are you known for something else? People, only half of you are looking at me, the other half are down. So there you go, okay? The whole spoken out throughout the whole world. Praise the Lord for that. But listen to me, faith can't be visible. Your faith will not be visible if verse 16, take a look, if verse 16 is not true of you. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. See, he went to the Jew first. The offer was legitimate to them first. They refused it. We got it. But listen to me now. I get fear. I have been preaching on street corners for some 12 years now. I've preached in factories where I've worked at. I've stood up on boxes and preached to people. I have gone door to door with gospel tracts, a Bible tucked under my arm, almost like a good little Mormon boy. I have preached the gospel at parties and events where people I thought were going to beat the tar out of me because they just wanted me to get out of there. I have never not been scared. Never. Every Saturday when we go out on the street corner, this man is afraid. Every single week. I have to pray and ask God to give me the strength. So you've been doing it for years. So what? This is a spiritual battle we're in. Do you think the devil wants me out on that street corner? No. You think he wants me opening my mouth at work? No. It's a battle over souls. But listen, it is not the Spirit of God that brings the spirit of fear. It's a different spirit. And we got to get over that. But listen, I've never not been scared. All right, listen, just the Galleria Mall when we did the hymn sing. Brother Adam, and I praise the Lord that Brother Adam came up to me before. He goes, "You going to say something after? You going to preach after? You going to say, just say something?" And I looked at him and I go, "Well, I don't know. I hadn't really thought about it." I said, "You know, I mean, we are in the mall and all, you know. I don't know how well received it would be." I said, I'll think about it. I'll tell you what, I went through that whole hymn sing, just the Spirit of the Lord going, "You better say something now. You better say something now." So the whole time I'm singing, I'm trying to pay attention to the lyrics. I'm messing up the lyrics left and right because I know I got to say something now. And I'm fighting it the whole time. Listen, I'm just being honest, folks. I'm scared. And so, you know, I just, Lord, just let me say, say something. Help me say something. And so it all closed up. Everybody's getting ready to pray. And I just, you know, let's just, okay, boom, here we go. You know, and the whole time I'm thinking, oh, they're going to invite us back. I don't know. I get this. How are people going to respond? Are they going to get angry? Are we going to get kicked out of there? Will we never be allowed to do that again? I get fear. But shame? I don't get that. Ashamed to identify with the Christ who wasn't ashamed to die for you? No, that I don't get. I don't get that. And if you are ashamed, something's wrong. Fear aget. Okay? I will encourage you. I'm scared too. Let's pray. All right? But folks, you're bearing witness of something. Something. I don't know. Some of you bear a record of your favorite movie. Some of you bear a record of your favorite sports team or your favorite restaurant. We bear a record of something. Our favorite games, our favorite activities. Some of you simply bear a record of yourself. And we're probably all guilty of that. Look at Psalm 25. Come on, this needs to be a verse that we just kind of hunker down on. Psalm 25, verse 3. Anyone here trusting on the Lord? Anyone here waiting on the Lord? Anyone here waiting for that day when He calls you home, right? You've put your confidence in Him. Look at verse 3, Psalm 25:3. Yea, let none that wait on Thee be ashamed. Let them be ashamed which transgress without cause. What is He saying here? We have no reason as born-again Christians to ever be ashamed of our relationship with God. Let them be ashamed for the way they talk and the way they dress and the way they act and the things that they say and do and how they behave. Let them be ashamed. Blaspheme the name of the Lord every time they stub their toe. Why aren't you ashamed? Willing to kill your children at the drop of a hat? You ought to be ashamed. Be ashamed. But because I know Jesus, I'm not going to be ashamed of that. Amen. Amen. Proclaim it. Proclaim His name. Don't be afraid. Or don't be ashamed. Be afraid and pray about it. Verse 19. And we'll be done for today. I'll tell you, that world out there, it needs more shame. Unbelievable the things that they say and do now. Just, I'm not even an old man, 43, and I got to talk like an old man. Man, back in the day, they didn't say things like that. They didn't. Kids didn't disrespect parents the way they do now. They just didn't. And I'm not old. If I did something wrong, my next door neighbor grabbed me by the ear, dragged me back home, kicking me the whole time. I didn't dare say anything back. I'm in trouble now. Ooh, I'm in trouble now. You know, instead of turning around at somebody who's three times your age and dropping an F-bomb on them, are you kidding me? Why do they do that? There's no fear of God before their eyes. And why is there no fear of God before their eyes? Because their parents raised them to not believe in God. I'm not talking about religion. Yeah, you had to go to religion class. I'm talking about the fear of God that was not instilled in you. Everyone that was raised in some sort of form of religion had Santa Claus as their God. You know, the God that always loves you no matter what, and though He threatens you with coal, He'll never deliver upon it because Santa would never do that. Guess what? God's dropping the judgment hammer. He's going to do it. He's not Santa Claus. Amen. Amen. Verse 19. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, "Perceive ye how ye prevail nothing? Behold, the world is gone after Him." What world is that? I don't know a world that has gone after Him. Not in the sense that they're proclaiming, as in the world wants Him. They went after Him to kill Him. They continue to go after Him to hate on Him now. Come on, you know it's so. I know not that world. I wish I did. I wish that was my world. And praise the Lord, we'll get that world. We will have that. But I think this priesthood is very short-sighted. And I believe that they're short-sighted because they can't see past their own mirrors. They're selfish. They are in their own little world. And it's their little world that was being threatened, not the world at large. It was their religion, their tradition, their prominence, their power, their money. That was the world that was going after Jesus. And that's why every religious institution in Western New York, whether it be Roman Catholic or Mormon or Jehovah Witness, whatever, Presbyterian, I don't care, Baptist, I don't care. That's why people get so worked up, because their power is being threatened by Jesus. He deserves the preeminence, and they don't want to give it up. So they keep you bound in some form of religion so that you need them and need to empower them. Oh, Holy Father, will you pray for my aunt? She passed away. We need to get her out of purgatory. Who told you that? That ain't anywhere in the scripture. Well, but my priest told me. Oh, so your priest told you to believe in that, and you have to give him money for him to pray to make that not happen. And you don't smell a rat?
Right.
Well, no, because it's a priest. He's a man of the cloth. Okay. I don't even know what that means, but all right. All right, here we go. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, right? These people, their faith was in them and in their ways, because their hope was in them and in their ways. And one must come to the complete end of himself in order to have a proper vision of who Jesus was and is. And we must remain at the end of ourselves in order to continue to see Jesus clearly for who he is and who he ought to be in our lives. As John the Baptist, or Elijah, you pick, once said, through the Holy Spirit, by the way, he must increase, but I must decrease. That's John 3 and verse 30. That needs to be the cry of every born-again Christian that names the name of Jesus Christ. If we can get to the place of putting him first, everything else will fall in line. Everything. The fear that you experience instead of witnessing, that can fall into line. Your unwillingness to forgive a brother or sister in Christ, you put Jesus first, it'll fall into line. Your unwillingness to give, your unwillingness to serve, your unwillingness to show kindness, all of that will settle in if we allow Jesus to increase and put ourselves back to decrease. Willing to do that? I'm telling you, all sin can be beaten. The problem is we're not willing. So let's take some baby steps, right? And find an area that we know we're weak in. Get down on our knees and say, Lord, increase in this area. Help me decrease in this area. And start taking control over your life. All right, so did we like the doctrinal or did we like the...